Women's rights movements began as far back as 1848 and are still in action today. We see time and time again that throughout history, women's bodies, lifestyles, careers, and decisions are influenced by men. And this is something that needs to come to an end. My name is Sophia Diaz, and today I will inform you of the famous civil rights leader, Betty Friedan, who helped advocate for women's rights by using her life experiences and rhetorical skills to connect to a wide audience. I will be discussing the life of Betty Friedan and highlighting her background, rhetorical skills, and legacy that propelled the women's rights movements to what it is today. Betty Friedan began her journey to greatness when she attended Smith College and earned a bachelor's degree in 1942. She then moved to New York to work as a reporter. By 1947, she was married and had three children, but unfortunately lost her job after being pregnant with her second child, which forced her to become a stay-at-home mother and full-time housewife. She felt very restless with this role and wanted to see if other women felt the same way. So she studied the women graduates of Smith College and then published her results. As reported by History Channel, Betty Friedan became a well-known author when she published The Feminine Mystique in 1963. After many life realizations and using her education, Betty Friedan went on to become a figurehead in the women's rights movement and gave a powerful speech in Chicago in 1969. This speech goes down in history and is a key factor in what Friedan's use of rhetorical devices and ability to connect to an audience would do for her. As discussed by Our Bodies Ourselves, during the 1960s, there was a major uproar by women to change the laws against abortions, in which they advocated for it to be legal and a safe process for them to undergo when they deemed fit. The speech was given at the first national conference in Chicago for the repeal of abortion laws to women, men, politicians, and government officials. The Thai group transcribed the speech, where she highlighted the risk of having it done illegally and the need for it to be made legal for the safety of women. Friedan also touched on the mental and emotional effects of how this affects their ability to be healthy mothers and wives. The feeling of invisibility and forced gender roles can cause them to become abusive to their children and even their spouse out of resentment and years of distress. Friedan used pathos as a way to connect to her audience. Pathos is used in a way that accesses the emotions and deeply held beliefs of the audience to draw them into the subject matter. Pathos often makes audiences feel like they have a personal stake in the information being provided, and is often the catalyst that drives them into action, as defined by storyboard.com. In the opening line of the speech, Friedan immediately causes an emotional reaction, in which she said, "Women, even though they're almost too invisible as sex objects in this country, are invisible people." By emphasizing the idea that women are objectified and seen as invisible by our country, Friedan is playing on the emotions women have against these assumptions and beliefs about them. As the speech goes on, she says, "Men are going to bear the guilty burden of the passive destiny they have forced upon women, the suppressed resentment, the sterility of love when it is not between two fully active, joyous people, but it has the elements of exploitation." By speaking on the quality of love women and men will have in their lives due to inequality and lack of freedom for women, she's describing their possible future or current romantic life, which would create a reaction within them. This reaction could be where one woman will personally agree, or where one woman will object and will not want that kind of life for themselves. Regardless, it will stir up strong emotions that will touch them personally. It seems that Friedan almost wanted her audience to feel outrage, anger, frustration, or maybe even companionship and empowerment, as she is speaking about their hardships and burdens and what is no longer acceptable for women. I think her goal was to push them to work towards making a change for themselves and other women, and to know that they are not alone. Logos is another thing Betty Friedan uses in her speech to open the eyes of her audience. Logos is known as logic, reasoning, evidence, and facts to support an argument. Logos appeals to the more rational side of an audience's mind and provides support for the subject matter, as defined by storyboardthat.com. As mentioned before, Friedan touches on battered child syndrome. It's defined as a disease in which children are physically abused. Child abuse also consists of mental and emotional abuse. In her speech, she said, The battered child syndrome that we are hearing more and more about today from our hospitals is almost always to be found in the instance of unwanted children, and women are doing the battering as much or more than men. In the case histories of psychologically and physically maimed children, the woman is always the villain, and the main reason is our definition of her. By mentioning the analyzation of case histories and the discussion of the syndrome in hospitals now, shows the audience that there is a reason to consider what she's saying, as it is shown by science and doctors. Towards the end of the speech, Friedan also says, "It's crucial, therefore, that we see this question of abortion as more than a quantitative move, more than a politically expedient move. Abortion repeal is not a question of political expedience. It is a part of something greater." After having explained the detrimental effects of stereotypes and gender roles on women, as well as the effects of unwanted pregnancies and limited freedom women have, she concludes by saying abortion is much more important than it is made out to be. She explains the effects not only have effects on women, but those around them as well, which shows the severity of the decisions the government makes in regards to women's rights. Rhetorical skills were also employed by Friedan, mainly anaphora and some examples of a synditon and simile. She uses anaphora numerous times in the speech, first in the beginning by saying, "Women who have a share in the decisions of the mainstream government, of politics, of the church, women who don't just cook the church supper but preach a sermon, who don't just look up the zip code and stamp the envelopes but make the political decisions, and who don't just do the housework in the industry." Friedan repeats "who don't just" and "of" to show the contrast between the first two thoughts, and to make something like a list to emphasize her key points. This is a good tactic to use because the repetitive nature keeps the attention of the audience as they catch on to the pattern she's using. She also does this again by asking a rhetorical question and then answering herself right after. She said, "Am I saying that women must be liberated from sex? No, I'm saying that dot dot dot. Am I saying that women must be liberated from motherhood? No, I'm saying that dot dot dot." This anaphora as a rhetorical question allows Friedan to answer any assumptions or clear the confusion the audience might have with what she means, showing that she understands her audience and is aware that misunderstandings may occur. She also uses a simile in which she compares women's lives to a cancer cell. Friedan said, "Like a cancer cell living its life through another cell, women today are forced to live too much through their children and husbands." This was a powerful comparison because cancer is a deadly disease that kills from the inside out, and it drains people of their lives, and this is what she's calling the life of a woman. She's drained in her own life because all her energy and abilities go towards her family and not other valuable things that built her up as a woman. Additionally, a synditon is used when Friedan mentions men and their role in society. She said, "Men have enormous capacities in them that they have to suppress in fear in order to live up to obsolete, brutal, beat-killing, Ernest Hemingway, Krupp Prussian, napalm all the children of Vietnam, bang-bang your dead image of masculinity." This long list that she creates without conjunctions shows a strong sort of emotion and intensity that she feels about the role men feel they have to play in society. It seems to build up and mock the ridiculousness that she feels masculinity holds in society today. Friedan's ability to connect with her audience by using experiences is what made her so legendary. By 1967 and 1973, there was a reformation in law in 14 states and even 4 repeals. However, the changes were so that women can only undergo abortion when the pregnancy was a cause of rape or incest. New York State was the first state to go against this and make it legal altogether, as long as it was no later than the 24th week. By 1973, the case of Roe v. Wade declared it legal for women to have abortions during the first trimester, as it was seen as the 14th Amendment right of privacy. One article published in the New York Times stated, "One of the chief architects of the women's liberation of the late 1960s and afterwards, a sweeping social upheaval that harked back to the suffrage campaigns of the turn of the century would be called feminism's second wave." Friedan said, "To confront our inequality, therefore, we must confront both society's denigration of us in these terms and our own self-denigration." The way she says this shows the audience that she sees the bigger picture, knows that work needs to be done to create change. and also employs them to work on themselves to make that change. Due to her status and educational background, it's very easy for the audience to trust her views and ideas. She is able to relate to the common woman by having a family and a husband and similar frustrations to them as well. This gave her credibility, as she was already a published author. All these changes would not have been possible without the work of feminist groups and allies, with Betty Friedan as a key player in this movement. Today, we are still fighting for our rights to keep our own power that is supposed to be protected by the law. With the current political and social state, we need to look back at history and be inspired by Betty Friedan and her willingness to speak out and revolt against what was in place for women. We have discussed how her personal life and education influenced her future position of power and ability to connect with the women of America. We discussed her speech she gave about abortion laws and why it was so important for that time period. We discussed how pathos, logos, and rhetorical devices enhanced her speech and invoked emotion within the audience members. And lastly, we discussed why and how she has the title of a women's rights pioneer. Betty Friedan was truly a trailblazer because she rejected gender roles put onto society without fear or shame. She made it clear that women are not just objects to be used as a service, but we are valuable members of society who deserve just as much respect and voice as any other man on this earth. Betty Friedan's work is what allows us to move into powerful positions today, and hopefully we will continue to change the world from the inside out. I hope you enjoyed my speech, and thank you for listening.